Hi, my name is Pete, and I've always been fascinated by IDEs. Their features, like jump to definition, rename refactoring, and scope aware autocompletion, are useful to me every day as a developer. But I never felt it was easy to see how they worked on the inside, or modify them to add new visualizations or support for new languages. I wondered, what if there was an IDE that was turned inside out, letting us inspect and visualize its internal data structures and algorithms in any way we wanted to? Today, I'm going to show you Lingo, an environment I've been building, which is a prototype of this idea. It allows you to define rich IDE support for new languages just by declaring a grammar and some Datalog rules. Lingo is built around the idea of representing a codebase as a database. Specifically, it represents syntax trees as rows and relational tables, and then evaluates user-specified declarative rules to derive information about things like scope and types. These rules, written in Datalog, are then queried by its UI to provide IDE features like semantic highlighting, jump to definition, rename refactoring, and autocompletion. So what does this look like in practice? Well, let's say we're defining a simple functional language with syntax that looks like this. First thing we'll want to do is provide syntax highlighting for our language. The simplest way to do this, which many editors do, is a regular expression-based tokenizer. That is, define a regular expression for each type of token in our language, for instance, variables, keywords, integers, and strings. This is a good way to get started, and it's supported by many editors, but it won't get us all the way to the rich IDE features we want. To provide these features, we'll need to parse our code into a syntax tree, and to do that, we'll need to define a grammar for our language. Zooming out, we can see that Lingo provides a box for us to type in a grammar. I'll paste one in. Zooming out a bit more, we can see that the environment is now displaying a syntax tree. It took our example and our grammar and parsed it into this tree. We can see that each node in the tree has the rule which was matched, the source code range for which it was matched, a star if the cursor is currently over that node, and a unique ID for that node. Now, when we go to the left and look at these tables, notice that there's one table for every rule in our grammar. Let's open up a couple key ones. You can see that there's one function call, two variables, and one let expression. So the environment is inserting a row into each one of these tables, each node in the syntax tree. It has a unique ID, it has a parent ID, thereby encoding the tree. Now that we have a full syntax tree, the environment can provide highlighting if we just tell it which color to highlight each of these nodes. I'll paste in a mapping here, which maps it to predefined token types. And now we can see that we have basic highlighting. But as I move my cursor over, nothing happens. I can't jump to definition. I can't jump to a placeholder, and there's no highlighting over certain variables. So the question is, to get these features, how can we explain to the environment that this X is defined here and used here? This is usually where there's a steep increment in complexity. In Visual Studio Code, we need to write a language server. In the IntelliJ family of IDEs, we need to write some Java code. This is frustrating because it would be nice to say this in a declarative manner. All we really want to say is if something is defined on the left side of the let expression, it's in scope on the right side of the let expression. So is there a programming paradigm which allows us to state this directly? The closest thing I've seen is a notation common in academic programming language papers called typing judgments. Now, I'm no expert on programming languages or logic, but the basic principle here is that for each rule, if the expressions on the top of this line are true, then the expression on the bottom is true. And variables bound up here apply down here, and this fact here can be fed into other facts or other rules in the system. Now, this is great, but how can we make it into executable code? It turns out that there's a programming paradigm which closely matches typing judgments called logic programming. In logic programming, you have a database that you can insert facts into, and you can define rules to draw inferences from those facts. There are two main logic programming languages, Datalog and Prolog. They're similar conceptually, but have different guarantees around termination. Lingo sticks a little closer to Datalog. As we can see in this comparison with SQL, programming in Datalog is a lot like creating views on SQL database, but Datalog syntax is much more concise. Most importantly, its use of variables makes complex joins much more ergonomic to express. So what does this look like in Lingo? Well, we already have all the facts we need inserted by the environment into the database from the AST. But now we need to define some Datalog rules to teach the environment what's in scope at each node in the tree and where those scope items were defined. I'll switch to a pre-built version of the language with some rules defined. Suddenly, with the addition of these Datalog rules, we can notice that the editor has come to life. We have this highlighting, where pink is the definition and gray is the usage. We can jump between definition and usage. We can rename variables. If we type in a placeholder, we get suggestions for things that are in scope. And if we introduce a type error, we get a red underline. And if we move the cursor, we get an error message, all with about 130 lines of data log. So how do these rules actually work? Well, everything is defined in terms of scope. So let's start there. Two most basic rules are scope.defin and scope.var. We'll focus on defin. So it's saying that there are three things that can define a variable which goes into scope. The first one is a built-in, like +2. The second is a let expression, which is what we have here. And the third is a lambda parameter. Let's click on this rule. So what it's saying is that there's a let expression that has a body, a binding, a variable, and if the type of that binding is type T, then we know that there's going to be a variable of name N with type T defined at the span of the variable within the body. So that's the basics of adding IDE support for a simple functional language. But does this generalize to other languages? It turns out that yes, a lot of other languages have notions of definitions, variables, and scoping. So we can use the same framework for those languages too. In fact, your language can have whatever AST it wants, but for editor support to work, you just have to define, at base, scope.defin, scope.var, and scope.parent. Scope.defin tells Lingo where in the AST variables are being defined, and scope.var tells the environment where they're being used. Scope.parent tells the environment which scopes are nested within other scopes, inheriting their definitions. Let's select another example language. Here's a simple subset of SQL as an example of a language which is substantially different than our functional language, but still fits into the framework. It's different because scoping works differently. For instance, the table name, which I say after the from clause, affects which columns are in scope here in the select clause. Also, instead of let expressions, everything is defined with create table expressions. Scrolling down a bit, we can see that there's a live GraphViz visualization of the schema of our database. Now, how's this working? Well, it's actually defined in just a few lines of data log here at the bottom of this file as a couple of queries, one for nodes and one for edges. Now, this is an example of what I call turning the IDE inside out. Normally, these data structures would be hidden inside of the IDE, but here, this is just data that we can work with in a query as if we're in a spreadsheet. Now, you might notice that the grammar editor here and the data log editor on the right have a lot of the same affordances as the example on the left. For instance, there's semantic highlighting, and we can do renames. That's because these editors are powered by Lingo as well. In fact, we can go look at the definition of the grammar language itself. This is the grammar of grammars. And we can look at the definition of Lingo's Datalog dialect. Now, don't worry, you can't break Lingo by editing these because there's a hard-coded copy as well. So that's my demo for today, but where could this project go in the future? Well, there are a lot of interesting directions. The core Datalog engine could benefit from implementing some well-known techniques for improving the speed and adding a negation operator, which would allow us to specify more complicated type errors. Also, I'd love to spend more time on the UI for database exploration and rule authoring by example, instead of just typing in a data log query. Also, adding support for more languages would really push the environment to its limits, like languages with generics, or perhaps a language with a Rust-like borrow checker. In fact, you could say that this whole project is the world's most roundabout way of learning Rust. Also, in addition to type checking, we could perhaps program operational semantics with data log, thereby allowing Lingo to not just type check code, but actually execute it, and maybe even giving us a time-traveling debugger for free. That's it. Thanks. This is live at lingoworkbench.dev if you want to try it out. Also, you can go on to github.com/filterp/datalogts or talk to me on Twitter. And I'd love to hear from you. Thanks.